Evening. Good everybody with us this evening. Like to continue our study in the area of Moses as we're looking at him and seeing at Hebrews chapter 11, basically dealing with the heroes of faith. And we're looking at this area of him. We looked up quite a bit of it last couple weeks, you know, actually a little longer than that, dealing. But we left off last week talking about the sanctification, as we would see, that is found in him. Walking in faith. And Hebrews 11, 28 to 29 is very clear about that. It describes it to us of what he did and what he was about. So we're going to be continuing in that area there. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 28 through 29. As we know, as we've been dealing with this, this section deals with the area of sanctification and the Exodus. And when we see this, we know that God's design toward the sanctification of Israel. And Exodus basically can be, can be seen in several ways. We know that the sanctification basically means to separate, and that holiness, you know, to keep separate from. And God is separating them from Egypt, and that's what we see happening here as he gets ready to do this and separate from them, knowing that in the calling of Moses, he proclaimed himself as Israel's God, you know, that they were his chosen people, and that they would go with him. Remember, they've been in Egypt for 400 years. They've been in captivity, in a sense. They were servants or slaves to that of Egypt. And we know that in Exodus 3:6, that God made it very clear to Moses that I'm the God of your father, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And wanted him to know that. So the Israelites were called upon to accept the unique position of the Lord and above the so-called gods, we would say, of Egypt. So later, we understand in, you know, Moses appears before Pharaoh, Israel is actually presented as the Lord's firstborn, Exodus 4:22. And the message to Pharaoh was, these people do not belong to you, they belong to me, they are my children, and this is the way things are going to be. So by stating that, we see this distinction between God's people and the Egyptians. And in fact, with the plagues that were designed to indicate God's choice of Israel, of his people. And remember, each one of the plagues had to do with different gods that the Egyptians worshipped and looked to. And we know without a doubt here that God showed, I'm more powerful than all of them, as we see that happening. So to kind of get back to where we were last week, to leave off with that, we know that God was able to finish their deliverance. And we want to notice that Moses is unshakable confidence in God. So we begin with Exodus chapter 14, verses we'll get to there in a second. Exodus 14, just remind everybody. So this is the Exodus where they took it. You see a little red dot. Don't know if you can see it online or not here. I'll tell you what. I'm going to go ahead and pump this up right here for a moment. Just give you an idea. And you can see here where we have this happening. The Exodus route goes this way. And they come down, and then we see that they're going to come through this area that is really difficult to travel. They're going to come out at this beach, depending on which way you think they came. But we're going to look at that tonight. We're going to make it very clear where they came through and remind us of some of the photos that we looked at last week and getting to what's there. So in Exodus 14, 13, 14, this is what was said to them. It states, and Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid. Notice, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. So this is what God tells them. You're not going to fight. You're not going to have to do any of this. God's going to take care of this for you. So what do we do next? Well, this is what happens. You know, where do we go? What do, Moses? Well, it says, the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. Go forward where? Remember, what's in front of them after they get through this long wadi, this long traveling area? I'll show you what wadi is in a moment. You know, they run into a sea. They run into, of course, we know the Red Sea. How are they getting through to that? Well, God is going to divide it. Look what he tells Moses. He says, well, lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. So we see them doing that. We see that happening. We know the Exodus that is there. And we begin here in Exodus 14, 19 through 20. We got this last week. That says, the angel of the God who went before the camp of Israel moved and went behind them. And the pillar of the cloud went from before them and stood behind them. So it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. Thus it was a cloud and a darkness to the one. and it gave light by night to the other, so that the one did not come near the other all that night. So brethren, when we see this, it makes it very clear that you notice the divinely provided separation. Here we see the separation, the sanctification that was taking place between Egypt and that, of course, of Israel. So the presence of God was one thing to the world and quite another to his people. The distinction was no doubt a great comfort to the Israelites. It is always better in the light than it is in darkness. The truth by which we are sanctified, John 17:17, is an obstruction to those who harden their hearts against it and what we found. So to remind us of where we were last week with these pictures we have here, I'm going to go ahead and start these, and I'll pull these up a little closer for those who are online with us to be able to see. So this is what we understand as we call wadi, meaning the water that runs through it, excuse me, and breaks things forth. And we see that they're going to come this direction from Egypt and come travel through this area here that you can see, hopefully, with the red light. So as we look at these areas, we're going to look at a few things. This right here is on Google Earth. I'm going to go ahead and get up here. You can see me up here. Don't know if you'll be able to or not, but this is what we would say Google Earth. Let me go over to here to this. I will go back to that. You don't need to see me. So this is Google Earth of what we understand. This is the wadi. This is where it's traveling through, and we see this happening and going forth. They're going to travel down through this area here and back around over here to this beach that we're going to see. And so this is live what you're looking at right now. And this is where they're going to come out to. This is this huge beach complex area. Because people were like, how could 2 million people fit through there? Because that's what we figure in the Exodus. 2 million people together with children, you know, adult, you know, men and the women and everybody that was there with the whole family. So we see that happening. So they come to this area as they would travel through this. So as we look at this here, I want to remind us of what this is going to look like. So I'm going to show you a quick video of what we see here. And it tells us Josephus. Now, let me go ahead and do this now. There we go. It says, Josephus, for there was on each side a ridge of mountains that terminated at the sea, which were impassable by reason of their roughness and obstructed their flight. So by stating that, what I want us to do is think about for a moment, is look at this area that we would see here in this video. And as we look to this, we're going to find some areas that basically go and freeze this for a moment so you don't see me loading everything up. We're going to look at this video, and this video is really cool. It's going to show us actually where they walked and what they were a part of and what took place in it. So as we look to this, we'll go ahead and begin real quick here. Let me go ahead and get started. Let me go back to here to freeze. All right, so here we go. Go ahead and let everybody see that. And we'll go and start this section here, this plane. So here's what we have. So this is where they're traveling, as you notice. And you're going to find here as you go through this area, this road, this is where all 2 million of them were. Now, it's going to move pretty quick. Someone's going to drive through this. But this is the exact area where we see and understand that that they are driving, where we see that they're actually, this is where the Israelites would have been walking at. So as you see, it's still going, moving forward, and everything is here with it. We see it happening. All right, so you see this. Look at these mountains. Look how high they are. And just, it's remarkable how tall these mountains are and what's going on here with them as we see this taking place. So as hopefully you can still understand and see what's happening here, as they're traveling through this and moving through this area, I want you to understand, I mean, just look at these. Now imagine 2 million people. And when you see these type of mountains like this, you realize and really get the idea of why they could not turn around. Why they could not escape any other way or get away from it. In fact, the Bible says this, Exodus 14:3, they are entangled in the land, the wilderness hath shut them in. And that's exactly what we see taking place with them. So here we find them continuing, moving forward through this area of these mountains and just this area of this wilderness that really, you know, is just so difficult to the terrain. And so they're having to move forward. They're still moving. You know, God told them, go forward. And so they're following through this, moving in the direction that they should be to get to where God wants them. And this is the same statement, basically, that you have here now that I said a moment ago, saying, you know, for there was on each side a ridge of mountains that terminated the sea, which were impassable by reason of their roughness and obstructed their flight. That's from the Antiquities of War. That's Josephus, historian, Jewish historian. So you can see the water, how washes away the road here. It's even going to get worse in a moment. And we see as we're moving forward, that is basically the opening. You see this opening of where it's at and where it's coming to, and you see what it's doing now. This coming there. Now, you're going to have two men come up here for just a second. It's only going to last about 10 seconds. They're the ones that are narrating this and talking about this. He's the one that actually found this area, was talking about this area, and actually was the one in the car describing it. So here you go. We see them moving forward into this area. And as you see this happening and moving forth, we realize, I'll get you a little closer here, let me go like this right here. We see where it comes out. There's where you see the sea, way over there in the background. Oh, let me go back. And this is where we see the wadi once again, where they were crossing, where they happened. And there's the sea. So now you can see the sea of what's taking place and what's happening here. And they're going to come to this area, and we're going to go ahead and stop this in just a moment. And it's just remarkable, the ocean of what they're handling. That's Saudi Arabia on the other side, where they would be going to. So we'll go ahead and stop this here in this moment and freeze it. Let me freeze this right here for just a second. All right, freeze. Make sure it froze. Yep, it froze. All right. So we'll get out of this and we'll come back and we'll get into our area here that we were discussing. So unfreeze this. All right. Get back to where you can see everything that's happening here. All right. Bam. Okay, so here we go. All right. So as we're continuing to study here, we continue to see what's happening, what's moving forward. My clicker's not working for some reason. Let me see, it must still be froze. And all right, so what's happening here? There we go. All right, so now we're going to do it. There we go. All right. So this is where we see them come into. This is the area of this great beach. And I'm going to leave this up a little higher. You're only going to see part of me because of what I've shown. This to those online can see it too. And this is a huge beach. Look at this area. Easily 2 million people could fit in there. You see it's cities now. There's little different things. There's some stuff actually on the beach. You could go there and look to that. So these are the pictures that I found here. And I want to show you some other things. Here's the view they would see at the Red Sea crossing. You know, Saudi Arabia in the distance of what was happening here and what was taking place. So let me show you some pictures of what they found in the water. And you think about this for a moment, that the above left photo is taken of a gilded, well, no, not yet. Let me see. Basically a gilded chariot wheel that remains on the sea floor. When you look at this, we see that it was found by Ron Wyatt, that's who we see dealing with that film a moment ago, using a molecule frequency generator from his boat above after he set the equipment to search for gold. The Bible said all the chariots of Egypt and 600 choice chariots or gold, veneered models were in the army pursuing God's people. It is speculated there were 20,000 chariots destroyed that day, brethren, that day. So it's pretty remarkable. So that's how you see it. That's coral around this one here. And that's what would be on the inside, is that we're able to look at it. But now this next one is really remarkable. So I want you to notice here, the above, basically left area here, the left area of this photo we see is taken up a gilded chariot wheel that remains on the sea floor, as we stated. So notice here, look at the wheel. You can see the wheel here turning. You see the spokes on both sides. And you see the center cap. Well, now, as you see that, I want you to think about now this next spot. Look at the one to the right. See, the above right, basically, we understand, is a drawing. And this is right here what you're going to find. Look at the similarity. Look at this. It's just remarkable. So as we look at this, this is a drawing of a four-spoke chariot found in Egyptian tomb from the same time period. 4, 6, and 8-spoke wheels are found here in the Gulf, and were only used at the same time during the 18th century, or 18th dynasty, or 1446 BC when the Exodus actually took place. Just remarkable to see what we have there. And then the last photo, I guess you can see here, I'll go and pull this one up even a little closer so you can actually look at this here we're seeing. So hopefully you notice and you see these bones. You have bone of a regular bone of a human we see with not being in the ocean. Here's one that has been. And you find these, and I'll just tell you a little bit about them very quickly. So as we look through these, we know that the basically these bones of a human.
We understand. You notice what it says.
There are numerous chariot wheels plus human and horse bones at the crossing site. Above on right is a human femur bone that is covered by coral, and it was tested at Stockholm University. It is from the right leg of a man, 165 to 170 centimeters tall. It is basically mineralized by resting in the Red Sea for 3,500 years. That's what we find with this. It's amazing. But that isn't it. We see also something else really cool. Notice this column here, and I'll bring this up again so you can see this really close. Here's this column that we see that's intact. And this column basically matches one on the other side of the Gulf in Saudi Arabia, which had inscriptions intact on it. It was actually laying down, knocked down, and been vandalized. But this is what was in it, the Hebrew word. The Hebrew word is Mirzum. So you have this Hebrew word named Mirzum, and it means Egypt. This is inscribed on the column on the other side, over in Saudi Arabia side, where the Israelites crossed over the Red Sea to it. And it says Egypt, it says death, has inscribed water, Pharaoh, Edom, Yahweh, and Solomon. They were all inscribed on the columns still there today. See, brother, King Solomon had these columns erected 400 years after the miracle of the crossing of the Red Sea on the dry land. Solomon's seaport was at the northern tip of the Gulf of Aqaba at Elim, which it says in 1 Kings 9:26, and was very familiar with the Red Sea crossing site, as it was basically in his backyard, in his neighborhood, you kind of say. The Bible even mentions this column in Isaiah chapter 19, verse 19. We see it says, in that day there will be altar to the Lord in the midst of the land of Egypt, and a pillar to the Lord at its border. You know, you can even visit the beach today and see the column in person as it's still there. So that's what we have about the crossing. We've gone through this for the last 3 or 4 weeks dealing with Moses. And it's just remarkable. Let me read Hebrews 11, 28, 29 again. It says, by faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of the blood, lest he destroy the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, whereas the Egyptians, attempting to do so, were drowned. Every single Egyptian was killed. Nobody made it out. Nobody was able to get through it. They all died. And so all the Israelites were able to get through, and then the waters came back and killed them all. We actually have evidence of these wheels, these, as we said, chariots, human bones, horse bones. All this is being found underneath that sea there of the Red Sea. It's pretty deep, so it could be difficult to get everything but what is there. But it's just really remarkable to show the proof that is found in God. That, you know, he talked about in the book of Exodus that was written by Moses. And that we see even today, we are still proving through archaeology that these events actually took place. So, all right. So that's where we are with that. We'll go ahead and close this section here of Moses. And I don't see hands or anything, so we'll go ahead and move on to Rahab. Here we have Rahab, transforming basically faith of Rahab. And before we really get into her, I'm going to ask you this. You know, who are the only two women, you know, that are mentioned by name in the list of the faithful in Hebrews 11? There are only two. And if you were to choose two to include, think about who they would be of the women of faith that you find in the Old Testament and what they find. You know, if you were to choose the two, the first mention that we would understand might make our list, without a doubt. In verse 11 of the book of Hebrews, it says, by faith Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed. She bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. So this is the wife of Abraham. That was the character. What was the character of her life? Remember, she was the faithful wife of the father of faith. She traveled all those miles with her husband. She eventually, we know, understand, you know, received the fulfillment of God's promise to her, and knowing that she would bear a son of promise, that would be Isaac, when we see that happen. So who would expect Sarah, you know, as we understand, to be mentioned in Hebrews 11:11? We would expect that without a doubt. She would be the one, and then we would look at that. Then the other female named in Hebrews 11 might not make our list. Might not make our list at all. In fact, we find here in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 31, that is Rahab. Notice what it says about her and her occupation. By faith, the harlot, Rahab, did not perish with those who did not believe, when she had received the spies with peace. Now remember, some people in the Bible are mentioned in connection with their occupation. We have Abel was a shepherd. In fact, we have David, he was a shepherd. David was a king. We have Matthew was a tax collector. Peter was a fisherman. Saul, remember Saul, when he Well, we saw Tarsus became Paul, of course, we know. He was a tent maker, and we see these occupations about them. But what was Rahab? You know, five times in the scriptures we're told that Rahab was a harlot, meaning that she was a prostitute. Brethren, when we meet her, Rahab's character is the polar opposite of Sarah and the others mentioned in this chapter. She was not an Israelite or even of the family of Abraham. She is definitely an outsider, both in heritage and character. The fact that this woman, Rahab, makes God's list here is as significant to understanding the character of God and the character of faith itself. See, brethren, through the story here of Rahab, we find out that anybody can come to God. Anybody, doesn't matter what you've done, who you are, how you lived your life, if you make the choice to leave that and follow God, to look to God, you can be a part of God. You can be a part of Christ today that we see and understand. This faith is remarkable of what we see in Rahab and what we see by her story. So we're going to continue in this area here. Let me go and read it now, Hebrews 11. We've actually already read it, but I'm going to go back to something that happened before it. It says, by faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encircled for 7 days. By faith the harlot Rahab did not perish for those who did not believe when she had received the spies with peace. Now we know Jericho has to deal with Joshua leading the people, of course, the Israelites, into the promised land that would be there. But we also understand that this really, the story of Jericho wasn't to be about Joshua. It's about to be about Rahab. It's about faith that is found in her. And God wanted us to know this as he had these words put down on paper for us to look to and have all our life in the Bible. So Rahab's story, we're going to start here. We know and understand that the fall of Jericho was a gift appropriated through the faith. They closely followed God's unusual instructions. But Israel's faith was not the only faith that God honored in the fall of the city. As we said, it is here that we meet Rahab, that we come into understand her. So let's look at the test of her faith. In Joshua chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, I'll go ahead and read these. And it says, now Joshua the son of Nun sent out two men from Achaia Grove to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, especially Jericho. So they went and came to the house of a harlot named Rahab. And they lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, men have come here tonight from the children of Israel to search out the country. So the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, bring out the men whom have come to you, who have entered your house, for they have come to search out all the country. Now think about this for a moment, brethren. Something we should know, Rahab is the only person in all of Jericho that we know by name in the entire city of Jericho. The Bible does not mention the name of the king, or of any great warriors, or statesmen, or even any of her family that actually comes to her house and actually is able to survive this. Nobody else is mentioned in this huge city that is fortified by these great walls. Well, brethren, we understand when we look at this that it is no accident that these spies end up at her house. See, God recognizes her emerging faith and is willing to put it to the test. We know that God can read her heart, knows her heart, and he sees this before, you know, this even takes place, before these spies even go see her. You know, and she has this faith in God, and we see this. That's what this is all about. Here's a Gentile woman living as a harlot, not living in the way that God would expect her to live. And she believes in God because of what she heard about the Israelites, about what God had done for them, crossing the Red Sea, the wars that they were in, that we're going to talk about with the Amorites and so on, before they even get here. And it's just amazing that she has this type of faith without seeing. It's the same thing you and I have today, knowing that faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God, meaning we see it and understand, but realizing and understanding also that this faith is not by sight, but it's what she hears and what she believes. What would possibly entice the Canaanite prostitute to help these enemy spies? The biblical answer, of course, is faith. She had come to be a believer of God. In fact, I want you to notice the response of her faith. She answered the request of the king in Joshua 2, verses 4 through 6, and it states these words. Then the woman took the two men and hid them. So she said, yes, the men come to me, but I did not know where they were from. And it happened, as the gate was being shut, when it was dark, that the men went out. Where the men went, I do not know. Pursue them quickly, for you and overtake them. But she had brought them up to the roof and hidden them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid in the order on the roof. Notice what she does here. She says, you better hurry up. You better hurry up and get them, because they're running away. They're going as far as they can. They're getting out the gate. So all of them leave, of course, real quick. They're probably looking for her to find them. And we know what happens here. So it becomes immediately evident that Rahab did what? That's exactly right. She lied. We see that she lied to the Jericho militia about the whereabouts of the two men. This has led some questions about God's commendation of her faith. You know, commending her faith on this occasion. How could you do that if somebody lied? Now, I want you to think about some things for a moment. She is a Canaanite, Gentile. She doesn't see anything wrong with that. She doesn't see anything wrong with living as a prostitute. Pretty much acceptable is what she's thinking. Does that mean it's acceptable to God? No way whatsoever. So we ask this question, did God condone her lie? No, not at all. Did the situation justify her lie? Some have said, yeah, I think it did, because God overrules everything. No, that's not at all. That isn't it. It did not justify her lie. And we're going to talk more about that also. We'll consider this a little later in a week or two, but I want to focus first now on how she expressed her faith. So we will look at this lie. We're going to look at this lie and how this came about and what we find with her. Once again, the way to think about us, remember, is think about who she is. The way she lived. She doesn't know any better right now. Thinks it's just kind of normal. And we look to that. So when we look at this area of her faith, I want to recognize the enormous risk that she takes here. Her, you know, concern is not just for three strangers, but her own family as well. In fact, brethren, notice this, that after the men, we see this, let's go back to this right here. After the men of Jericho are gone, Rahab goes and speaks to the spies on the roof. And she says this in Joshua 2, 9 through 13. Now before they lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land, that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt. Now notice she's saying, we heard these things. The whole city has, the whole town. It says, now what you did to the two kings of the Amorites, who were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon as we heard these things, our hearts melted. Neither did there remain any more courage in anyone because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God, in heaven above and earth and on earth beneath. Did you catch that? What she said? He is the God of everything, is basically what she's saying. Not from what someone told her, but what she has heard. And then it says, verse 12, now therefore I beg you, swear to me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness, that you also will show kindness to my father's house and give me a true token, and spare my father, my mother, my brothers, my sister, and all that they have, and deliver our lives from death. Brethren, this is just remarkable that a woman that is a Canaanite, she's a prostitute, we see she's a liar, she's lied, and we understand, we look at this, we think, how could somebody like this have this kind of faith? Now, I want you to get this. The entire city had heard about the Israelites, had heard about God. What's amazing is it seems she's the only one. The only one that believed how powerful God was and what he could do. See, brethren, when you look at this here, it's amazing that everybody had the opportunity to come to God, because remember, God knows their heart. And we see this. The spies were sent specifically. See, Rahab's words were here to help us understand the development of her faith in the time of crisis. She, as well as others, had heard how God delivered the Israelites from Egypt and how he miraculously sustained them through the victory over the Amorites. She is convinced, without a doubt, that God, the God of Israel, is about to conquer her city as well. And she wants to enter into an agreement with the spies and their God. She believes that God can save her and her family and is willing to beg for her mercy. So, brethren, when you think about this and realize these people here, God will put people in the path of someone that is believing him, looking at him, if they're not a part of him yet. And this is exactly what happened with Rahab. that we see and understand this taking place. Brethren, notice, if there had been anybody else in that city that would have been believing, that would have thought this about God, would have had this kind of faith, God would have had somebody sent to them, but it didn't happen. She is the only one. It didn't say her family did, it just says she did, but her family would come to her house, we understand later, and be saved through her faith. Action. It's all about the action that is found in her faith. Not just a belief, but actually understanding, saying, I believe this is the true God. So that's what we see with Rahab there. Next week, we'll get into the nature of her faith. In the text, Hebrews 11, Rahab is contrasted with those who basically do not believe. And we'll see that. So this one, we're going to go ahead and close this here and come back to this next week, as I stated. And we'll just see the importance that's found in her and what is described. And I hope we just continue to really realize how great of a story this is and how important the story this is. To show that it doesn't matter where you are in your life, what you're about, that if you come to God, if you come to Christ, we know back then they didn't have baptism in the sense, as we understand, they were under the Mosaic law. We know today with Christ, if we believe, we pray, confess, baptize, remission of our sins, if we come to Christ, we can have that salvation and continue in it. But this is what's so cool. It doesn't matter where you are in your life, who you are, you can find your way to God. And God will accept you and let you look to Him and continue with Him. And that's what we see in the story. And we'll read a lot more about this and talk more about it as we get into this next week. So we'll go ahead and close there. We'll go ahead and move from here into our area of our devotion in just a moment. So I want to thank everybody for that and just appreciate your time. Thanks.
Tonight, number 0, and we'll be singing that right after Bill does the invitation this evening. Ronnie, would you take the closing prayer tonight? Got quite a few announcements. Ernie's going to help me out, and possibly Kalita, in case I just I've missed something. I don't have them written down. Of course, we want to remember Kevin Tubbs and continuing his therapy. It's good to see Dennis here tonight. He seems to be moving around pretty good, so we're glad for that. Baby Cooper is in the hospital, if you didn't already know. He has a severe case of RVS. RSV, I'm sorry, I got it back. RSV. He is not voiding like he should. He is supposed to have like 5 messy diapers a day, and he's only having what, 1? And so they're trying to find out what's going on there. He's vomiting stuff up when he shouldn't have anything in his stomach at all. So they're really concerned, and of course Chelsea's spending the night there with him, but please keep him in your prayers and we find out what's going on and find out as soon as we can. Ernie's mom had some tests done today, and she has, Ernie, you can explain it better than me.
They put an endoscope, and she has ulcers in her esophagus and very inflamed, bad. She has another hiatal hernia that they found, and they put her on some medication. She's supposed to come back in 3 months.
Okay.
Checking all that.
So keep Lavina in your prayers. Our son Michael lives in Florida. He thought he had torn the mesh away from his hernia, but they now think he tore his abdominal muscles. And so he's got to have some tests done, and he goes back next Wednesday, and he's in a lot of pain. So please keep him in your prayers. Let me see, who else am I forgetting? We're still waiting on a room for Peggy. We're still trying to get her in to a facility. So keep her in your prayers. And I think that's the sick that we need to mention. There is a sign-up sheet in the foyer for Super Saturday. So please look at that tonight and sign up if you can. Also, there's a few cards back there still, if you haven't signed them, to do that. We've turned to Sunday. Sunday is our Valentine's party. We have some things to do for the kiddos and the adults, and you still need
names and ages.
Names and ages of the kiddos that are gonna be there, hopefully. We have about 20 young people. 28? About 28, if they all came. So
that includes grandchildren.
That includes the grandchildren and so on. So please help with that if you can. And if I understand the menu, it's sort of like a tailgate party, just finger food stuff, something easy, nothing really elaborate or heavy. Because I know the guys are going to get home, and isn't the game this Sunday?
Yes.
Yeah, they're going to want to get home, get comfy, and get ready for that. So we want to have two good things in one day. And so that, as far as I know, that all the announcements that I know of, and today is what, the 8th? The 8th or 9th? What is it? The 8th. Chad's not here, is he?
He's not. He's a birthday boy.
Yeah, he's a birthday boy. He stayed home just because he knew he was going to get sung to, didn't he? No. I'm only kidding. Is there anything else that we need to mention tonight before Brother Bill comes up? If not, Brother Bill?
Thank you, Ed. I want to talk a little bit tonight about the joy we share in our faith. You know, we spent part of last week in Savannah visiting Will, who is finishing up his 3rd year of medical school. I would have to throw that in here. I just want to throw it in there. By the way, I was looking for her just a minute ago. And, you know, this little break that we had visiting with Will, I'm not a big TV watcher. Athletically, I love watching sporting events, but I don't binge watch anything, and I'm not really, you know, a guy that watches a lot of TV, but there's a show that kind of caught my attention during the time we were there. It's called Alone. Any of you have seen the show? It's on the History Channel. You can also get it, watch it one series after another called Alone. You know what I mean? Okay. Very interesting concept of the show. Basically, you're dropped in the wilderness of Canada alone, and you were told to survive. And there are 10 people in it. The person that makes it to the very end gets $500,000. Okay? You are able to take 10 items with you. Here's the point of this brief lesson on joy, the joy that we share together. You would think thirst, hunger would be the immediate thing that knocks them out. You know what takes so many of the people out after 30, 40, 50 days? Literally being alone, not having the shared community, the shared joy that we have in our faith. You know, Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23 talk about joy as being a fruit of the Spirit. It's something that we know. And I was thinking about a lot of the writings that Paul gave us. Some of them were done in prison. And if you think about the joy expressed by Paul in a lot of his writings, this was a guy writing from prison, from bondage, from a loss of liberty, from oppression, from a tyrannical government, from a real feeling of loneliness, and yet he was all in isolation. He was always able to communicate everything he felt with great joy. So I want to read a little bit of Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 to 11. Let me just read a little bit of that to you. Because it struck me as a real good example of what Paul was saying to us relative to the joy that we share. You know, our joy that we have in our faith is not based on external circumstances as Christians. If so, you would be depressed every day, wouldn't you? We don't have that. That internal joy doesn't come from what we see on the news, does it? I don't watch news that much, but when I do, it's just an earthquake that kills like 12,000 people, and over here you got a Russian army invading a fellow Ukrainian country, and then right here in our own country, on any given day, you're going to see a shooter have a mass killing somewhere. And closer to home, we know that even with our own family unit, our own family members, that interruptions in our health can set us back. But our faith is not based, our joy is not based on the external circumstances of life, because the bad things are always going to be present. But if you think about it, our faith, our joy is based on a real deep-seated sense of happiness we have and sharing our faith with each other. And think about the things we've shared here. You may not think it's a big deal, as I do, having a really nice meal over there. I had as much fun on Sunday with everyone over here a few weeks ago as I could possibly have had with all the food. And I look forward to what we're going to do this Sunday. Every event we have here, every worship we have here, every chance I have to be here and see you brings me joy. I love it. It feels good. And our shared joy, what we share together, it's just a really good thing. And I'm gonna read a little bit of Philippians 3. 1, 3 to 11. And this is Paul writing, again, probably from prison. Always, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, for you all making requests with joy, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Even as it is meet for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you are all partakers of my grace. For God is my record, how greatly I long after you all in the bowels of Jesus Christ. And this is a unity expressed by Paul and a joy expressed by Paul that we share a common love. You remember the song, A Common Love? You sing that? Remember, I love that song so much. We're going to sing it soon. I'm going to give Carson a lead and sing it. And that is just a delightful song. So remember, as we complete our week, and as we go through the week, the joy that we share together is just so, and we don't take it for granted. We love and enjoy and have great joy in sharing our faith together. So back to the show alone. So the number one thing that takes them out, and they were going to keep them out there up to like 180 days or something. And if they made it 180 days, it was going to divide 500,000. By the way, you know what day they made it to? Well, I'm going to ruin it for you right now if you go watch the show. The longest time any other day out there was 74 days. 74 days. It doesn't sound like that long, does it? But you know what? The thing that took them out is the loneliness they felt of not sharing the joy of their family. And that, most of them focused on that. Well, the thing, we were worshiping at the Central Church of Christ in Savannah this past first day of the week, and they're looking for a preacher down there now. And but what a joyful congregation they had down there. They remember us every time we go in and visit. They remember us, and we share a joy because we have such a sense of eternity with us. We know that we're looking forward to it. So anyway, that's it. Think about joy the rest of the week. Think about joy is a gift from God, and it is a great gift from God. Did you have a song?
Zero. Yep. How great thou art.
What number?
Zero.
Great. You're subject to invitation anyway. Come to the stand, sir.
Oh, Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder come.
thank you thee for all the life's blessings that thou hast bestowed upon us this far, our lives and our health. We thank you for this opportunity we've had to assemble here together as thy children and study another portion from thy word. We pray, Father, that the things that we have learned here tonight will be most beneficial to us. Build us up, make us stronger in the faith. And we pray that we might be shining examples unto others because of it as we go out into this world, so that they too might come to know thee. We're thankful, Father, for the gift of thy Son and the love that he had for us, that he was willing to die upon the cross, that through his blood we could have the hope of eternal life. For we know, Father, that without thee and without him, we would be lost eternally and in total darkness. We ask thee to be with those of our number who are sick, those who were mentioned here tonight. We pray that the things being done restore their health. Act swiftly and be in accordance with thy will, so that they can take up their places once again. Father, I ask a special blessing for Mama. Thou would watch over her. Pray that her suffering might be eased. And pray that with thy help, soon she will find placement in a home. We ask thee, Father, to be with all those who proclaim the gospel throughout the country and throughout the world, and we ask that many souls might be added to the church through their efforts. We ask thee to go with us now as we depart from this place. Watch over, protect us, guide us through this life. Bring us back on the list of the Lord's Day here, for we may worship thee in spirit and in truth once again. And Father, when we stand before thee on the great and final judgment day, if we're found faithful in thy sight, having done all that thou hast commanded us, may we hear thee say, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter ye in. All these things we